This is Radio Windy Bay, and it's welcome you all to the Windy Morning Express on this Friday's edition. The 18th day of the month of June 2021, to God be the glory. Last working day of the week, we say thank God it's Friday. Showing to the weekend, the weekend start right from here on the Windy Morning Express, live on 88.3 FM. So between now to the 12:10, it's been a pleasure, my duty, to welcome you to the show. I will bring you radio lecture this morning. It's for all level handed students studying the course GPDR 111 Communication Skills. And the topic is Developing Study Skills with Ms. Akosianani from the Department of Communication and Media Studies. Don't forget, still lines will be activated for you to be part of the lecture this morning. Just write down the number ahead of time. 0503-923-158, 0503-923-158, and 0332-320-201. WhatsApp and text is 0503-923-158. Don't forget, we're streaming live on Facebook, Radio Windy Bay 98.3 FM, and you can also listen to us live on university homepage. That's www.uew.ed.gh. So you can also listen to us live there. My name is Kim Patrick. On behalf of the morning crew, welcome you to the show. It's Windy Morning Express. Time for me to welcome Miss Akosua Anane as she takes over radio with this morning's radio lecture for all level-handed students studying the course GPDR 111 Communication Skills on the topic Developing Study Skills. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good to see you.
Good to see you too.
Right, I guess the students are ready for this morning's lecture.
Good morning, dear students. You're welcome to GPDR 111 Communication Skills. It's a pleasure to come your way again for such yet an interactive session. On our menu today, we are looking at developing study skills. We all know that as students, our primary reason why we are here is to study. And so we will not take the studying aspect of our stay here as an easy thing or as a joke. So we have to take it very, very, very serious. And then coming from the SHS, we know that there was a timetable for all of us, or for you as students, where there's time for you to go and eat, there's time for you to sleep, there's time for you to do all your activities. So in general, your stay there was planned for you. But then you find yourself in this big academic institution where you are left on your own. You decide when to take your bath, you decide when to study, you decide to go for lectures and all that. So at what point do you decide that I have to do this, I don't have to do that, I have to apportion my time and all that? So to succeed in this discourse community, which we all know we are in, you must develop a personal schedule, and that will enable you study and also participate accordingly in all spheres of this institution. And so therefore there's a course which has been structured for all of you so that it will help you whilst you are here, primarily in your studies. And so the first question we'll ask ourselves is, how do you succeed in this academic environment? How do you do it? And so the first thing that as students we must try to do, or you must try to do, is to employ effective time management skills. Very, very, very necessary. Employ effective time management skills. So as students, you must adopt effective time management skills to learn, and then in other extracurricular activities. So you must plan your schedule. You must have a personal timetable. And so I want to think that all of you have personal timetables aside the university timetable with your courses and where to go for lectures and when to go for lectures. You also have your personal timetable. So aside the fact that you are done with lectures, what do you do in the course of the day till you retire to bed? And so you must have a personal timetable and be disciplined enough to follow that personal timetable. You must wake up on time. you must go for lectures, you must have time to eat, have time to relax, have time to study on your own, have time to also go for study groups and all that. So you must employ effective time management skills. Another thing that you must look at in developing your study skill is also to join a compatible study group. And here the underlined word is compatible. Nobody will force you to join a group you don't align your feelings or you don't align your thoughts with. So if you join a group and then you think that this group, their aim or their reason for being there is not in accordance with what you are looking for, you step out of the group. So join a compatible group and then be serious in the group when you go. Members of the group, one, must have similar objectives such as achieving academic excellence. Of course, that is the primary reasons why you are here. So if you go and then it's all about gossip and talking and doing all sorts of things that is not beneficial, I will advise that you leave. So the underlying word is join a compatible group. Again, members of the group should be conscious and also opinions and ideas must be shared freely. So you must join a group where when you go, your opinion is counted. You are also regarded. Some people, when they go to a study group, they take control. What they say is what must be taken. What others say is wrong. No. Everybody's opinion must be respected because the ideas are not in one person's head. So that is why you must join a compatible study group. There should be nothing like intimidation from other members. And then you all study so that at any day, you all rise together. And so the idea in the study group is to help each other and then be one another's keeper. So after you employ an effective time management skill, you join a compatible study group. Then we ask ourselves, what are some of the advantages of joining a study group? Someone will say, but I've come this far without a study group. So what is the essence of joining a study group? Now, when you join a study group, you think with others. You learn onward if you have not already realized that back in SHS, it was you, yourself, and you alone. Everything, even when you are studying, your friend asks you, you lie and say you're not studying. When you move on to higher institutions or higher academic institutions, you realize that you ride on the wings of others. So when you study with others, you think together about academic problems. That is one advantage, is that it helps you to think together with others, as I've indicated. It allows you to discuss your challenges concerning a particular topic. Sometimes you sit in class, the lecturer comes, teaches, and then you realize you didn't get anything. Sometimes you feel all alone, like you are the only one who didn't take anything home after the lecture was done. But when you go to your study group, that is where your concerns will come out. You would say, I didn't understand. This man will also say, I also didn't understand. Then you feel like, okay, I'm not the only one in this ocean. Others too didn't understand, so it's okay. And so this is where those who got the ideas or those who got the concept will try and explain to the others in the group. So you will get different perspectives to the topic or the concept that was taught at lecture, so that when you go for lectures, the lecturer will teach, you get ideas, you get different understandings. So when you meet at these group discussions, people give their different perspectives and then you add it to yours. And then when it's time to reproduce, you know that you get different perspectives to your idea. You also explain better when you explain to others. So you have consumed so much information, it's in there in your head. But then you realize that when you go out to the study groups and then you discuss your the ideas that are in your head, you realize that you are able to explain it better. And in explaining better, you get a more grasp of the concept, because the more you are explaining, the more you are getting different concepts or different ideas to the explanation. And so when you go there, you also get your friends who also had different understanding to the topic, and then you all share ideas. Then again, you think together, resulting in higher quality of learning, as I indicated earlier, when you go to the discussions and then you are giving out your thoughts, your perceptions, perspectives, others also bring theirs on board. And as they do, you add it to yours. And as you are adding to yours, you are getting more ideas. And so when it's time to reproduce, you realize that it's not only yours, but you add more from the perspectives that you got from other members. Then you also discuss, the discussions at the study groups also help you to write better. So if I've indicated, you are getting concepts and ideas from others. So it's helping you to write better, because you are getting a lot of perspectives from one concept, or if it's a definition, is an idea, you are getting different perspectives to it. So you gain more understanding. And then also you realize that when you are in study groups, you share problems and you help one another. Of course, sometimes you have personal issues. I'm not saying when you go to study groups, that's where you go and pour out your family issues and personal issues and financial issues and all that. No. But you realize that sometimes you have some serious academic problem, like you don't understand when they teach, or your mind is running wild whilst you are at the lecture room and all that. So when you go, you talk to your friends about it. Some of them can help you. So in sharing your problems, you become like a family in the group that you form. You become like a family. That's to say that you don't go primarily to learn and then you come out. Of course, you have to share in each other's problems and solutions to it, so that at the end, when you all go there, you have a level playing mind. You all are at peace, and then ideas will start flowing. And so that is that for the reasons why you should join a very good or compatible study group, and then the advantages that you would gain from being in that group. And then also you go to running an effective study group. How do you run an effective study group? How do you ensure that you go to the study group and you don't just go and talk? You talk about all other things, but what you went there to do. Talk about all other things, and before you realize, oh, it's time, and then you're almost closing, then you just do 30 minutes serious work and you come out. At the end of the day, you will not achieve anything. So how do you run an effective study group? It is important to identify that the group requires cooperation. If you don't cooperate with each other, then why are you there? So that's the reason why I said the underlying word here is compatible. You should all be able to cooperate with each other. Members must come together to study the course, submit assignments, revise for examinations. That's why I said you don't go there just to learn and come out. You are a family. You do everything together. So you are each other's keeper. You share your problems. You share concerns. So you are supposed to submit assignments. When you go, have you submitted your assignment? Have you done it? We are coming for midterm exam. We have to study and all that. So you all do these together. Your all group members must participate and contribute to discussions. Yes, some people are there just to pray on you. P-R-E-Y, pray, feed on the intelligent ones. No. All ideas must be respected. Everybody must share. You don't just go there to consume. You don't be selfish and consume. At the end of the day, you don't give nothing. No, we don't do that. So all of us, or all of you there, must be there to offer individual perspectives to whatever is being done. And so in doing that, you are being effective in the study group. And then also we have guidelines to help you in studying, or help you in running an effective study group. That is to say that when you go for the study group, you should have a leader, someone who will coordinate the affairs of the study group. So more members must agree to arrive on time for meetings, all members must prepare well before coming. So there should be a topic for which you are going to discuss. You don't go there and then now you're going to plan. No. So you plan before you go. You should also have a personal timetable for the group study. Or for that group, you should have a timetable of which everyone is abiding by. So everybody, when I take my timetable, when you take your timetable, you know today you are going to do literature, or today you are going to do economics, or today you are going to do this. So you prepare effectively. And so you all prepare well before you come to the meeting. You pay attention and not have private talks or discussions. We are not saying when you go study, of course there can be jokes just to release tension. Some people will be feeling sleepy and all that. So as a leader, you know when to break the ice, know when to say we've had enough of study, let's stretch a little. Know when to say, oh, we've laughed too much, let's be serious, and all those things. And then also share books and relevant materials with all members. So if you have some books or you have some information that you think is relevant, share with others. Be respectful and don't underrate anybody in the study group. Respect each other, respect everybody's opinion, and then you are being good in the study group. Don't feel like you are the overall. Without you, the study group will collapse, or if you don't come, nothing healthy will go on there. No. Everybody is there to offer his or her perspective. That makes the group what it is. So respect everybody. Wait till it's your turn. And don't interrupt others while they are speaking. Some people, they are like that. They will not wait for you to finish what your submission. They will just cut in. Or some people, you realize that some people, immediately you start talking, they will debunk what you're saying and want theirs to be accepted. If you are like that in the group, know that this is a human institution. You could be right, you could be wrong. Respect others' opinions and all that, and add it to yours. Of course, that is not to say that if someone is making a wrong submission or someone is quote-unquote polluting others in the group, someone will not come out to clarify issues. We are not saying that. But some people would not allow others to talk because they would say you are not making sense or anything like that. Listen to everybody and then adjust or readjust whatever they say. Then be friends and supportive at all times and take hand out to absentee members. So you know genuinely a friend is sick, couldn't join at a point in time. You can go and visit and then let the person know that this and that is why what we did, and so it will help. And so be each other's keeper, as we have indicated. So now we are looking at being in a group and then studying well, and then how to succeed in this academic environment. So the first one we looked at was employ effective time management skills. The second one was join a compatible group. So underneath is what we have, the advantages of studying in a group, and so on, running effective study group and all that. Then the third one is that take notes and make notes. So when you go for in developing an effective study skill in this academic institution, you must take notes and make notes. Very, very, very important. When you go for lectures, you must take notes and make notes. So that will help you in your studies. And so when you want to succeed in this academic environment, it is important for everybody, all students, to take notes and make notes. This is a vital thing for every student in this university. You have to take notes when you attend lectures. You have to make notes from books that your lecturers will ask you to go and look for or engage with. And then you have to read. And then in doing so, you are taking notes and then you are making notes. And this takes us to a very important topic, which is note-taking and note-making as part of developing your study skills. If you don't take notes, if you don't make notes, then how do you study? So it's very important that when you go for lectures, you take notes, you make notes. So we ask ourselves, what is notes then? If you are supposed to take notes and make notes, what are notes? Or what is a note? A note is a record of what is heard or read during a lecture, during a discussion, during a talk, during a seminar, radio lecture, whatever. But the most important thing, or the underlying word here, is a record of what you hear and what you read. So what you hear, you put it down. What you read, you put it down. And in so doing, you are note making notes, or in so doing, you have notes. So notes are usually skeletal. You know, you are not writing detail. It's a skeletal of reflections of an entire lecture or reading material, radio lecture, and so on and so forth. As humans, our mind, we might have limitations and so on. You forget things and all that. So when you read and you listen and you write, it helps you when you are making your notes, when you are listening to your notes, when you are note taking and note making. And so it will help you in our day-to-day, in your day-to-day activities. So that is notes for you. Now the question is, what is note taking? When you are taking notes, T-A-K-I-N-G, what are you doing? So basically, note taking is a process, because you can't end, you can't stop. Whilst you are staying here, or you're doing your stay here, all you do is take notes, make notes, read and study and all that. So it's a process of writing or jotting down the main points of a lecture, a talk, a discussion, a radio lecture, a seminar, etc. A process of jotting or writing down main points or salient points of a lecture, discussion, talk, radio lecture, and so on and so forth. And in recording what one hears, as I said, in a lecture, what one hears. So note taking is a record of what one hears at a lecture. So for example, if you are in a meeting, you listen to what the person is saying and then you are jotting down something, you are note taking. During this radio lecture, as you are writing something down, you are note taking. When you go for a lecture, the lecturer is teaching, you take something down. This point is good, this point is salient, I need to put it down. You are note taking. So when you are doing all these, you are note-taking. So note-taking at lectures, note-taking at a meeting, during a discussion are all examples of note-taking. I suppose students are with me. Beautiful. And you are putting down questions or suggestions or whatever that might come up as the lecture is going on. So we look at the next one, which is note-making. The first one is note-taking. From a listening or what you hear source, writing down what you hear. Then you do note making, which is a process of jotting down main points from a written material or a written source or a reading source. So for example, you've gone for lectures, then afterwards your lecturer tells you, go to the library, locate this book and read further. And so as good students that you are, you go to the library, you locate the book, and the book is such that you can't be allowed to bring it out. What do? You sit there and you read. And as you are reading, you get some salient point. Then you tell yourself, okay, this point is good, will benefit me in my discussions, in my writings. So what do? You jot the salient point down. And as you are doing that, you are noting. Making, note making. So in note making, you are reading from textbooks, you are reading from magazines, you are reading from journals, and you are jotting down the main points or important information in the form of writing notes. And in so doing, you are doing note making. Now let's look at, we have looked at two concepts, note-taking, note-making. Let's look at the differences between note-taking. So I'll throw the question to you. What do you think is the major difference between the two, note-taking, note-making? Yes. So in my earlier submission, I said it. The main difference is that whereas in note-taking, T, you get the information from a listening source, or you listen. In note-making, you are reading, right? So the main difference is that in note-making or in note-taking, whereas in note-taking, you are writing salient point down from a listening material, so from a listening source. So for example, as you sit in the comfort of your rooms, or as you sit waiting for another lecture, as I am talking, you are writing salient points down. You are note taking. Whereas in note making, when you go to the library or you are reading something from the internet, you go to Google, you get an information, and then as you are writing, oh, this is good, this point is beneficial, you are note making. So one is from a listening source, one is from a reading source. That is the major difference. And then we look at, how do you take care of your notes? As students, how do you take care of your notes? I know you have done all these through your academic journey. So how do you take notes? Let's just go through. Read your notes immediately after a lecture or at the end of the day. So if your lecture is flexible enough, so after one lecture you have a period of time before the next, sometimes you even go for one lecture and you don't study, you go for another one the whole day. After you are done, now you immediately read over your notes. If it's not immediately, make sure you do so before you retire to bed. So read over your notes every day. This to enable you correct mistakes and also to add more information or explanation to what you wrote during the lecture or as you were reading for the information. Use your notes during discussions. When you go for group meetings and all that, use your notes. Be discussing concepts and all that from your notes, so that when you go there and there are corrections to be made, sometimes you think you heard this, but all the others have a particular explanation or a particular sentence, then you do your corrections. Compare your notes with others and fill all the gaps, as I've said. Edit language, edit information, edit whatever. Sometimes there are blank spaces you didn't hear. You said, which is quite rude, but students do it. And your lecturers couldn't fill the holes for you. Others also couldn't. Others were also here. So this is where you fill the gaps and do all that. Update your notes with current information by reading. So you'll be referred to other books to read. And as you are reading, you update your notes with other key concepts, other things that are other new things that comes up. So then we look at usefulness of notes. What is the use of notes to you as a student? So notes serves as a record for future use because it serves as a guide when one is revising. Of course, when it's time for revision, how do you revise? You fall on your notes. It enhances recall. So as you have your notes and you read through, you recall during the lecture what the lecturer was saying, and then you are just remembering as you are reading the notes. You are gaining more insights. It helps in preparing for exam. So when it's time for exam, how do you study? You fall on your notes. And then also, notes serves as a summary of what one has studied. So in all your understandings, in all your dealings, you have your notes to serve as an understanding and all that. And then again, we look at the advantages of taking or making notes. What are some of the advantages of taking notes? When you take notes, you become an active listener. And one thing I will encourage students is that when you're at a lecture, don't be in a hurry to write what the lecturer is saying. Listen, understand, And then write in your own words. I always advise students, listen, understand, and write in your own words. Sometimes the lecturer is given a key definition of which you must write word for word. Of course, when it happens, they will relax for you to take that definition or something like that. But when he's explaining a concept, when he's explaining an idea or something like that, listen first. If you listen, you get the understanding. So even if the lecturer is not there, even if you don't follow anybody's words, you can write in your own words how you understood it. So that is the one of the advantages. Makes you an active listener because you want to listen before you write. Or it makes you an active reader because you want to read and read well before you write down the salient point. And then also note-taking or note-making helps in understanding of a lecture. Of course, once you become active in listening, you understand. Because you want to understand and write. And so that is that for some of the advantages. Now I'll leave others for you in the face-to-face interactions, such as how to make notes during lectures. You listen carefully before you start writing, as I indicated, and all that. So during the face-to-face lecture, your lecturer will take you through more detail or more examples during that time. Good. Now let's go to another important aspect of our developing study skills. So as we are writing our notes, there are certain things that we must do in order to cut down on the bulk of information that we are writing. So sometimes you realize that as you are listening and you are writing, you lose track of what your lecturer is saying because you want to write exactly verbatim what the person is, your lecturer is saying. That's why I said initially that listen before you write. But if you want to follow in what you want to use the exact words your lecturer is saying, you must, there are some techniques that as students we must adopt, or as students you will adopt in reducing your note taking and note making activity. So let's look at the reduction techniques for note taking and note making. Reduction techniques. Your notes are your personal properties, your personal it's personal to you. When you go in the information there, you and you alone must be able to understand. So what are some of the things that you do in your note while taking your notes or making your notes to reduce the size? Sometimes the person is the lecturer is talking and is talking about a Ghanaian. Are you going to write the whole full meaning of Ghanaian? Or there is a way you can write Ghanaian or Ghana to make it, to reduce the size, and also letting you know when you come back to the information that this is Ghana I wrote, but to reduce the size, the quantum of information that you are writing, because you are dealing with time and all that. Now let's look at some reduction techniques for taking notes and making notes. So reduction techniques refers to the techniques or skills that are used to reduce the number of words when taking or prepping notes or preparing for notes. And the reduction technique, it helps you to reduce your writing load. Yes, as I've indicated, there's no way you can keep up with the pace of at which your lecturer is writing, reading or lecturing, as I indicated. So by the time you finish the first sentence, the lecturer might be somewhere, somehow gone. And so that these techniques will help in reducing your writing load as much as possible. So the first one that we'll look at is try and incorporate the use of abbreviations in your write-up, in your note-taking, note-making. What are abbreviations? Someone will ask. They are short, or they are the shortening of words or titles. You can use your own personal forms of abbreviations. Yes, some of you have your own personal, that's why I said your notes are unique to you. So there are some shorthands you use, and it's unique to you alone. You know what this short form means. And then they are sometimes too, they are universally accepted, which are abbreviations, which are usually found in dictionaries. So for example, as I indicated, Ghana, G-H-A-N-A, right? But if you want to abbreviate Ghana, what do you use? Or what do? You shorten it and do G-H. And sometimes it's even, it has become commonplace. It has become common use. We all say G-H. In GH, in GH, yes, so everybody knows GH means Ghana. And then you can either, you also use others, population, you are talking about population, then you do POP. So in population, in the population census, then you do in POP census, in Ghana, and then you do in GH, and you are going. So it tends to reduce the size of your writing load. You are writing pregnant, you do preg, p-r-e-g, and all that. I know you have so many. So during the face-to-face interactions, your lecturers will ask you to give a lot more that you have up your sleeves. So aside the use of abbreviations, use symbols in writing. Symbols represent certain long words and even sentences. So in mathematics, when you're writing something in your lecturer talks about something, says in addition, you don't have to write the all A-D-D-I-T-I-O-N. You can do the in and then do the plus sign, right? So as you're reading, you know this is addition that you're talking about. So use abbreviation. In the population, less than so, use the less than sign, greater than, use the greater than sign, so on and so. So you can use symbols. You can also use acronyms. So you are writing Economic Community of West African States. Can you write the whole Economic Community of? You use the acronym ECOWAS, UNICEF, UNESCO, GRASSAG, NAGRAT, Bank of Ghana. You do BOG, and so on and so forth. So there are several acronyms you can also use in your write-up. Then also you can use mnemonics. You can use mnemonics. So a mnemonic is a string of letters or phrase or a sentence that is meant to assist in remembering something. Let's not go into so many. Remember when you were in school, you were learning signs, right? And then there's this knowing about the planet. And then there's something, students devise something, my eyes may just see under nine planets, right? You remember? Good. That is what we mean by mnemonic. So you realize that each letter of the words you have created, my eyes, represents the the planet. So we have M stands for this. E is that ice. E stands for this. Earth, May. M stands for this, and so on and so forth. That is mnemonics. Or is it chemistry or physics? One of them. You were asked to learn the chemical compounds or something, and you realize students were able to, in previous discussions, students were able to remember some of the techniques they used in remembering that particular element. Yes, so we'll have more interactive sessions when you meet your lecturers face to face, if you have not done so already. And so that happens then. So that is a mnemonic. So under reduction techniques, you have the use of abbreviation, you have the use of symbols, you have acronyms, you have use of mnemonics. So that is ways in which you can use to reduce the size of your notes. Now, with that said and done, let's look at some of the types of notes that we have. Types of notes. We have talked so much about notes. We have talked about taking and making notes. Well, what are some of the notes that we can do? We have even discussed some of the reduction techniques. So what are some of the types of notes? There are two main types of nodes. These are diagrammatic nodes, which is also known as pattern nodes, which sometimes are referred to as graphic organizers. And then we have the undiagrammatic nodes. So we have those with the use of diagrams. We have those without the use of diagrams. So let's take them one after the other. When we talk about diagrammatic nodes, we are looking at their dynamic, their colorful, their memorable ways of summarizing a topic, a lecture, a discussion on a single sheet of paper. Now, remember that when you're talking about diagrammatic notes, it's on a single sheet of paper. These notes are arranged in patterns and they convey a step-by-step presentation. They are orderly presentation of information. Because of this, diagrammatic notes present information in such a way that you can see the main points and how they are related at a glance. Now we said they are colorful, they are memorable. Colorful not as in color, red, gold, green, no. But in ways that when you depict these diagrammatic notes, they give you an idea. You are able to capture the image in your mind's eye. So that if you close your mind and you have a particular diagrammatic notes, you can just close your mind and imagine, see it in your mind's eyes. That's why we say they are colorful, memorable ways of. And so when we talk about the diagrammatic notes, there are two main types. We have the spidergram, also known as nuclear, also known as spray, also known as branch notes. And then we have the outline notes. So with the diagrammatic notes, those are a little with them. They are with diagrams and all that. So we'll leave that for the face-to-face interactions where your lecturers will draw and do the illustrations for you to see how it is. But we have to learn that there are diagrammatic notes called spidergram, outline, and then another type of diagrammatic note which is used for special functions. It's also called the graphic organizers. So your lecturers will take you through all the various types, one after the other, and then you identify the various types under them. You will see how the spidergram looks like. You see how the outline notes looks like. You see how graphic organizers, what they are, and the special functions they are used for, or the special diagrams, notes that they can be used for. You can't use graphic organizers for all types of notes. No. So your lecturers will take you through so that you have a one-on-one interaction and understand a bit more. So we'll leave the aspect of the diagrammatic notes and then go to the diagrammatic notes. So when you talk about the undiagrammatic notes, we are referring to notes that are ordinarily writing. You just write them. You are writing in prose. They are arranged in a particular order. They take the form of ordinary writing, as I've indicated. And then one must read before you understand. You must read the prose before you understand. That is the undiagrammatic notes. And the undiagrammatic notes, examples are quotation, paraphrase, summary, headline techniques, and all that. So under undiagrammatic notes, you can summarize your notes, you can use direct quotations, you can use paraphrasing, and then you can also use the headline technique in writing your notes. So we'll look at them one after the other. When we talk about the quotation, you are looking at the exact representation of what the person said. And then how do we know it is a quotation? You bring the quotation sign. So sometimes your lecturer is saying something about an authority, an author, and then you don't want to lose sight of the exact thing the person said. You quote. But it's not advisable that we use all quotations in our write-up during note-taking, note-making. No. once in a while you quote so that you let people know you really know what you are talking about, or you are in direct connection with what the original author said. Or sometimes you don't want to use your own words to distort the meaning of the meaning is so valuable that you want to represent it as it is, then you use quotations. So that is quotation. And then if you write quotation, how do you know this is a quoted word? Then you use the quotation sign. Then everybody knows this is a quoted concept, or this is something that was quoted. So that is for quotation. Then you go to paraphrase. You can paraphrase ideas. So as your lecturers are teaching, you can paraphrase what they say. That's why I said listen, understand, and write in your own words the main salient ideas. Again, we go and meet an information. You read a book. You read something from the internet. What do? You read, understand, and paraphrase. So in paraphrasing, you are restating the core information of a piece of work by maintaining the main idea of the parent text. So the main salient point, you repackage it in your own words, or you package the whole by just getting the main ideas. In paraphrasing, the text does not necessarily have to be shorter than the original text. In paraphrasing, sometimes you go and meet a one-page document or one-page information. In paraphrasing, it doesn't have to be less than the one page. It can be less or more. The emphasis is not on the volume, but being able to get the salient points down. So in doing so too, you must not lose focus of what you are saying or the salient point in paraphrasing. So someone will say, Madam, so what is the difference between the paraphrasing and the summary? Because it looks like we are all doing the salient point. We are all looking at not losing focus of what the original author said and all that. Then we come to the summary. So in summary writing involves writing the salient points of something that one reads, one listens to, and so on and so forth. In summary, your information must be brief. It must be shorter, briefer, if I can use that word, than the original text, right? So in paraphrasing, the emphasis is not on whether it is short or long. You can go longer than the original text. But in summary, if the information is a one-page document you are summarizing, in a day, when you are finished summarizing, you should have about half a page. Do you get it? So the difference, students will ask, the difference between a paraphrasing and a summarized piece of information is that with paraphrasing, emphasis is not placed on volume. You can summarize something, one sentence, you can paraphrase it to be about five lines. How well you understand it, you can write about five lines. So it means that invariably, the paraphrased information is even longer than the original text. It's accepted for paraphrasing. But summary, it will not be accepted. Summarizing will be shorter. So if it is a sentence which has been given to you and you are being asked to summarize, you can even get a word out of it. So for example, in paraphrasing, you have a text that says, Baba had a baby and could not take the exams. As a result, she did not graduate. Baba had a baby and could not take the exams. As a result, she did not graduate. That is paraphrasing. Now, that is the original text. Paraphrase it. You can say, Baba did not graduate because she got pregnant and did not write the exam. Accepted. When you come to summary, we have a text that says, Betty had a baby and could not take the exams. As a result, she did not graduate. Or you can even use the same name, Baba. In summarizing, you have Baba could not graduate. She's pregnant. Period. Simple. Straight to the point. You don't add, you don't subtract, and all those things. You just take the selling point. Why didn't she take the exam? Why didn't she take the exam? Yes, because she could not graduate. Why? Because she was pregnant. And so that is that. Then we go to the headline technique. When we talk about headline technique, we are talking about using information that represents the whole info. Sometimes making it shorter, sometimes making it longer, but most often making it shorter. In doing this, all details and whatever are left out, but the salient information is maintained. So using headline technique, you maintain the salient idea. You do away with all the unnecessary wording and all that. A typical example of headline technique is how newspapers caption their headlines. Right? So you go and go to the front page of a daily graphic and then say, boom, is it boom something? Or all die be die. All die be die. 2020 elections, the one we just did last year. Then it say, all die. NDC or MPP declares all die be die, period. Now when you go into the news where they indicate where the news will be or the information will be, then you go and read the more into what the all die be die means, or you see a headline technique that says man 20 defiles man 60 defiles child 6. It gives you an idea, right? So you know that there is a man who is 60 years old who has defiled a 6-year-old girl, and so you have an idea about it. So when you go, then you go and read further that the man lives in a slum in Kaswa and blah blah blah, and the child went to watch TV and all those information. But the salient point is what they have brought out. So that is how the headline techniques can be depicted. So you can go and use all these in your notes taking, your notes making. So headline technique, it will be very good for some of the topics that your lecturer is treating. You just use the headline technique. And then in your free time, you go to the library and then you read more on it. So that is that for the undiagrammatic notes. At this juncture, I think I would pause and then invite some questions, some submissions, some whatever. And so students are advised to call the studio lines 050-329-3158 050-329-3158 or 0332-320201 0332-320201. Alternatively, you can reach us via WhatsApp or text on 050-392-3158 050-392-3158. As I've also been informed that we are streaming live on Facebook. We are live on Facebook, and so students can also post their questions there or give us more insights or perspective to what we have discussed. But basically, we have identified developing study skills. We have all come to the conclusion, or we should all come to the conclusion, that in our stay here, we can't do anything without primarily studying. All other things aside, studying is very, very important. And how do you do that? To succeed here, you must employ effective time management skills. You must join a compatible study group. And then you must take and make notes. Very, very, very important. Then again, we have also looked at note-taking and note-making, where we looked at notes as a record of what you hear and what you read at a discussion, a seminar, a talk, presentation, and so on and so forth. We have also looked at the fact that in note-taking, you are taking the notes from a listening source, or you are listening and you are getting the information. You listen and write down. You listen and you write down. So that is note-taking. Whereas note-making is taken from a reading source or a written source. So the internet, Google, you are note-making. When you get a book and you are getting the salient ideas, you are note-making and all that. So after all that has been said and done, we say, how do you take care of your notes? How do you make notes and all that? So viewers can join in and then we have an interactive session. Do we have a caller? There are some text messages. Okay, so let's have this text. Okay, hello.
Hello, good morning, madam.
Good morning. Your name and your department. Can you lower the volume of your radio set, please?
All right, madam.
Good. Your name and your department, please.
This is Alex Maga.
Okay. Which department?
From Economics Department.
Good.
Group 4.
Good. Lower the volume. We are getting feedback.
All right. Is it okay now?
We are getting an echo. So you lower the volume and let's listen to you through the your mobile phone.
All right. Is it okay now?
Can you move away from the radio set, please?
I've turned it off.
Beautiful. So let me hear your question.
All right. So I have some couple of questions to ask.
Okay, let's be snappy because others are also behind and waiting.
All right, so the first one is, there are some students who study better independently than in a study group.
Good.
Okay, so is it necessary for those students to join a study group again? And would you still recommend such students to join a study group? And then the second question is that, you said the popular term among the students is quite rude. And why would that be considered rude? Well, some of the lecturers know that, yes, it's part and parcel of us. And then, again, we just learned about note-taking and note-making, in which one is from the listening source and the other is from the reading source, respectively, if I get that clear.
Yes.
Now, my question is it advisable for students to use phones in note-taking during lectures? If yes, why? And if no, why? And again, for the benefit of students who are more compatible with the use of phones during lectures, and some lecturers aren't cool with that one too, how would you deal with that one too?
Alex.
These are my questions. My regards to Madam Bello. Thank you.
Alex, is that your name?
Madam.
So in using the phone during a lecture, then the issue is you don't listen because you think the phone is doing what you are supposed to do. How then do you listen? I would advise that if you don't have a special problem, you don't have a special need, you don't record those information, you listen and you write. And as you are listening, we have discussed that you become an active listener. And once you are listening and you are writing your own words, you are imbibing the information better than you are doing on your phone, right? And sometimes you won't even have time to go and play back what you are doing. And then it becomes uncomfortable for you when you have to refer to your phone for information other than on what you have written down. So I'd advise that you do that. The next one I said, students, when they can't hear something, the lecturer is talking, they can't hear, what students say is, huh? And I said, that is quite rude. So maybe if you didn't get me well, I said, huh? That is what is just rude about the whole thing.
Hello.
And then there is another, a last question, but I didn't get it. But there is another caller on the Hello. Line. Hello, caller.
Hello, good morning, madam.
Good morning. Your name and your department, please.
Please, I am Eric Bingoni from Art Education Department.
Okay, Eric.
Madam, I appreciate your good work this morning.
Thank you so much.
Please, madam, according to your explanation, you made mention that what happened at the lecture is an example of note-taking.
Yes.
My question is, what if a lecturer projects information on a screen and students look on it and write, will it still fall under note-taking?
In that particular instance, two things are going on. You are making notes, you are taking notes. So as you are listening to what the lecturer is saying and you write it, right? Maybe he projects something, you write it, you are making notes. You are writing the salient point down. Now, when he finished writing, what does he do? He would explain. And as he's explaining and there are insights you didn't get, you write it. So during that time, you are note taking. So you can, one lecture, you can be doing two things at the same time. You can be note taking, you can be note taking or note making. Yes, I think there are some few messages. Okay, so someone says, Sandra from Economics Department, she says, please, pertaining to study groups, is it the only way to succeed in this academic environment? There is a caller. Let me handle the caller first. Hello. Hello. Okay, we've lost the caller. So Sandra, it's one of the ways. What I would say is that do what you think is best for you. Some people have been here or have come through this far without being in a study group, SHS, you yourself, and but we say it, there's more knowledge in learning together. What you think you knew when you go to the study group, they would debunk it, then you put it aside and take on new perspectives.
Hello.
Hello.
Good morning, madam.
Good morning. Your name and department?
My name is Abdul Samad Eli, calling from the Art Education Department.
Okay.
Okay, I want to ask this question. I have friends who claim all the time that when lectures is ongoing, they will not take notes. And their excuse is that the moment they finish the lectures, they are able to capture everything in their head and there is no need for them to take notes.
Okay.
And so I want to ask for you to clarify to some of this whether that is a good attitude or not.
My dear student, I cannot sit here and say whether that is good or not. Some people are naturally like that. They listen, they capture, their IQ is so high. Once they are in the lecture, they capture everything and that's what they need. They don't need to write, they don't need to. We have individual differences. So if you think that, don't look at others. You are here as an individual alone. So what is good for you? If you think joining a study group will not help you, please don't join the study group. Learn on your own if that helps. If you think that you are that type that needs to take notes when you finish, you come and read the notes, study for like a week before you're able to imbibe concepts for exam, do what is best for you. Others too, all they need is to be present at the lecture. But then I'll say no man is an island on his or her own. So at least writing something down and so on and so forth won't hurt a fly. So yes, people do whatever is good for them. But my gentleman, look at you and forget about them. Do you? Is that Hello. Okay? Good. Hello?
Hello. Good morning, madam.
Good morning. Your name and department?
Please, I'm in Sierra Kennedy, Geography Department.
Okay. Kennedy.
Please, my question is, sometimes you go for lectures and the lecturers will fail, maybe. What you are writing, there is everything they tell you, so you have to buy the textbook or something. So I'm asking whether, is it good for you to depend on the textbook or you still have to write the notes? Or because they said, then all they are giving you are in the textbook. You have to depend solely on the textbook.
Kennedy, we have you have been trained that it's not only the lecture that you gain information. You have to go to Google. You have to buy books. Very, very important. You have to buy books. So if there are books available that will give you better insights or add on to what your lecturers are saying, why not? Buy them. That is why you are here. You go to Lulu's and you go and eat a lot of cornies and you buy pizza and you are eating. At the end of the day, what would the pizza do to you? But when you buy a book and you're able to keep the book well, it helps you throughout your life. It will give you something solid for your library. So buy books. I always encourage my students, buy the books. Buy them. Of course, I'm not saying don't buy pizza. Buy pizza, but buy books. Don't make it seem like it's a punishment when the lecturers ask you to buy the books. Buy them, use them, get your degrees. Go out. Sometimes you realize that you are out and that book is still helping you. So yes, I would advise you to buy books. Add to what the lecturer said at the lecture. Add to your notes you take. And then gain better insight. So that when you are making out an argument, you are well grounded. According to this, madam, I read this. Doc, I read that. Prof, I read here. Then the lecturer knows that my student is well grounded. He knows what he's about. He's reading. Now, the students don't like reading. You don't like reading at all. You should read. The knowledge is in the reading. So read and buy the books. Yes, so we are looking at developing study skills. We are still waiting for your calls and your messages and all that. And so Sandra was asking if participating in a study group is only way to succeed. And I indicated that do what is best for you. Do what you think is right. If you are able to study better, it helps in a way. It helps, trust me. Sometimes you are at lecture or you are writing an exam and then there's a concept, you forget the definition. But then you cast your mind back to the discussion and you realize that this person explained this. You can be able to recall what the person said and then it comes to you like that. The brain is such that it comes to you. And so you write it down like that. So yes, it's good. But if you go and you think it will not help you, then I advise that do what you think is best for you. Do what you think can help you succeed here. That is all. Okay, so still on the... I'm recapping what we have looked at. So we looked at reduction techniques as well for note-taking, note-making. So the use of abbreviation, use of symbols, use of acronyms, use of mnemonics, and so on and so forth. Then we looked at the types of notes, which are the diagrammatic and undiagrammatic. So do we have a message? Okay, so there is a message. From, okay, I didn't get your name. Psychology department. Someone is asking for the difference between abbreviation and acronym. Okay, so as we indicated earlier, we said an abbreviation is a short form of a word. So if it's Ghana, you just shorten it to GH. And then the acronym is a representation of words or the word that you use the initials. So if you have Ghana National Association of Teachers, you have NAT, UNICEF, and so on and so forth. Vivian also wants to know. Okay, the text messages are so many. Is jammed. Okay, so I explained this and explained again. I said with paraphrasing, the emphasis is not on the quantum. You can paraphrase longer than the original text. But with summary, the text must be shorter than the original text. The summarized version must be shorter. So if you are given a whole paragraph or a whole page, you have to summarize to a different one. Someone is asking how many members constitute an effective. Hello. There's a caller. Hello.
Hello. Hello. Good morning.
Good morning. Your name and department. Okay. You want to?
I want to make some contribution.
Please do.
Okay. With not making, it is not just about writing down everything you hear or you read, but also one should be able to process and then review and connect it and then also synthesize information and ideas. That's what he or she read from the lecture or what he or she read. We think it's because it will help each student or anyone who does that to engage and stay active during lectures or when he's reading or he's writing. And also,
I'm listening.
Okay. And the aspect of joining a compatible study group. We made a point where the points where we should protect the leaders to be that group.
Your line is breaking.
And you can hear me.
I can hear you now.
Okay. I was saying that in the aspect of the study group,
mm-hmm.
we made mention of that we should select a leader.
Mm-hmm.
But I also think that with the leadership, they should be shifting things completely. So enable the students to be active and study more and prepare and stay engaged in everything. And then finally, I want you to throw like on the information.
All right, so thank you so much for your submission. We appreciate it. And so, are there more calls? Okay, so Gilbert wants to know how many people constitute an effective study group. I will not be quick to say have this, have that, but it's a small group. So not less than 3, no more than 10. Even 10 is too much. No, an appreciable number from 4 to 8. Yeah, you'll be good to go, so that when you go, it won't be so much. It's serious stuff, because the more people, the more the likelihood that you just be doing things that are not really relevant. So Francis wants to know how many hours can you spend at a group discussion. That would be relative to the members. That's why I said you should have a timetable. You all agree that after 2 hours, you know, the brain gets tired and all that. So you decide if you can go 2, 3. That is up to you. You can even break and come back. That is all dependent on the group. So have some itinerary or have some plans or some written something in place that when we go, we'll come at this, we'll close at this, and so on and so forth. So as for the time, it's all dependent on you. Then someone is also talking about I should highlight on note making and note taking. So as I've said, whereas one is from a listening source, the other is from a reading source. That's the main difference between the two of them. Amoa is also asking, in case of tiredness or fatigue, and you are not able to read your notes before going to bed, does it mean you are not taking care of your notes? Of course, we get tired all the time, But the advice is that try and read over your notes before you hit the bed. Try and read over. Try and recap what you've done. So you can do that by going for a discussion. Even 30 minutes reading through won't be a bad idea. Yes. So you condition your mind or train the mind or the body such that before you hit the bed, you read 20 minutes, 30 minutes, you are good to go. All right. James is asking, people who participate more when studies in study groups are in session, and due to this, they want to act as if they are the best ideas. And yes, that is why I said sometimes there are people in the group, they think theirs is the best and all that. That's why you should have a leader, a group leader. You have a group leader who is such that he is able to monitor all these, a mature mind who is able to bring all on board. So if someone wants to dominate the group, that leader is in the capacity to bring the person to book and all that. And as I said, no man is an island. So don't think that you know all. You don't know all. Ideas are in other people's minds. So give room for that. And don't pay attention to those who behave like that. And then Clinton wants to know, is it vital for a first class student to join a study group for the betterment of others? Of course, sharing is caring. Share your knowledge, share your ideas with others. Then you all rise, you all move as a group. So if you are in geography department, they will say the 2020-2021 group, they were excellent. And you are proud that you were one of those who championed that course. Yes, so there's joy in riding with the others. Someone says, I have stopped joining study groups because the trained teachers think they know more than the bad. Okay, so the trained teachers, I think you should stop doing that. You should give room for everybody to operate. So my dear, if it's because of the trained teachers, join a group that doesn't have trained teachers in there. Okay, and join a group. It really helps. Trust me. Martha wants to find out, Madam, do we have any challenges in note taking? Do we have any challenges? Are there any challenges in note taking? I would rather want to dwell on the advantages rather, that it helps you to be active in class. It helps you to be a good reader and listener and so on. Disadvantage, there's a caller. Hello, caller.
Hello, good morning, madam.
Good morning. Your name and department?
My name is Ayama Bewin Jonathan from Special Education Department.
Excellent.
Madam, I want to know, can we also use summary in note making and note taking? If yes, which way?
Of course you can summarize. You can summarize by listening to your lecturer whilst in the lecture. You listen and then you write in your own words. And in writing in your own words, you are summarizing. You are writing the salient point that the lecturer is saying. So yes, you can summarize, you can paraphrase, you can use headline technique. You can quote. Your lecturer will say, take this quotation down. Or you go and meet an information in a book, in the library. You write verbatim what the original person said. So you can use all these techniques in writing or making or taking notes. Yes, so today the discussion has been on developing study skills. So we know that at the end of the day, studying is the most important thing aside all others. Josh from Art wants to know, note taking is from a listening source and note making is from a reading source, which are all verbal communication. I want to ask about jotting from nonverbal communication. So what is jotting from nonverbal? If you are jotting from nonverbal, you are doing note making, right? Because that form of nonverbal communication is like a text you are looking at. Yes, so if there is no form of communication, then you are doing note making. So this morning we have looked at developing study skills. We'll leave the rest of the discussion on during our one-on-one interaction with our various lecturers, and then we'll keep the conversation going. Collaboration among learners when learning. How can we increase collaboration? That's why I said we have different perspectives, we have different people in a study group. So make sure that you give room to others as they are speaking. Know that you don't have all the ideas, right? So when someone is talking, respect each other's opinions. Now, when you respect each other's opinion, irrespective of who the person is, then there'll be collaboration. You are all collaborating with each other during the studies. Then another person also wants to know, so under receptive language skill and productive, that is from a different lecture, right? But receptive is when you are receiving the information. Productive is when you are producing the information. Okay, so Ruben wants to find out, is there any difference between headline and topic? A topic is about what you are going to talk about in the lecture. But headline technique is all about the ideas that you get from the topic. You put it in the headline. So under food nutrients, which is a topic, you can look at protein as an example of a food nutrient. So you write proteins, benefits of protein, sources, deficiency. Those will be the headline techniques, right? Beautiful. Okay, so we have looked at AEC wants to find out, is it good to have more than 5 study groups, as in 5 members in the study group, or you and if an individual, you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 groups that you visit? If it's like that, no, it's not the best. Have one group that you align with and go and study with them every time. Don't be visiting one group after the other. They will not take you serious. Yes. So we'll leave the discussion for other for our face-to-face interaction, and then we'll engage our lecturers more. But the emphasis will be on the diagrammatic notes, where they will take you through the various examples, the spidergram, the outline, and then the graphic organizers. So we have had an interactive session this morning, and then we'll meet again hopefully next week. Let's continue the discussions, as I've said, during our face-to-face interactions. Until then, do have a wonderful day and enjoy the weekend. And so, from the studios of Radio Windy Bay 98.3, has been your lecturer, Akosua Santua Anane, from the Department of Communication and Media Studies. Have a wonderful day, and bye-bye.